Hey, this is Will Power, and you're listening to the Indie Sports Car Podcast.
Welcome back, ISCP fans, to another guest we have on for this week's ISCP Appreciation Week for drivers and media that have supported the show. And I'm almost nervous to welcome David Mulcher of Motorsport.com. David, how are you?
I'm very good, thank you. And certainly no need to be nervous. You're the one that's used to being on the podcast. I'm an occasional broadcaster, but nothing as important as ICSP.
Well, yeah. I mean, this is our 99th week of being a show.
That's impressive, right?
Thank you. And at number 100 next week.
I did that math in my head, actually. Yeah.
Rock on. Well, you know what? That's why you are the editor in chief of. Well, what is your official title? Yeah, because is it editor in chief of IndyCar or
just the old man? I think. But no,
the old man.
theoretically, U.S. editor and IndyCar correspondent, but in fact, I don't control the NASCAR content. That's done very much on the. But on a different branch of the site, actually. And but it's going nicely. We have people there that are so knowledgeable that they marinate in NASCAR knowledge. So there's definitely no need for me to dabble in there other than occasionally proofreading their work. So, although it says US editor, it's more open wheel and sports car to a certain extent. But I have a fair bit to learn on the sports car side, I must confess.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of the same way. I mean, the Indie Sports Car Podcast. We put sports car in there because me personally, I was an American Le Mans fan, not so much a Grand Am Rolex fan. The merge, I have a lot of things to say about that, but won't get into it now. That's another podcast for another time. That everybody keeps telling me to shut up every time I get into it, but anyway, as far as me, IndyCar is my first passion, so Indy's the first name in the podcast. And when we came up with the name, we figured we wanted people to read it, know exactly what they were going to get, and I think they do when they read it. It pretty much says what it is.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, thank you for inviting me out.
I can't thank you enough for coming on. I mean, I see, Missy and I, we see in the media center every race we go to. We say hi to you. You couldn't be more nicer. And you also wrote, I get these wrong all the time. So is it the autobiography or biography?
It's a biography. Yeah. Okay. I didn't ghostwrite it for Will. I assume that's what you're referring to.
Of course.
Will Power's biography. Uh, I I wrote and thoroughly enjoyed writing. And I look forward to adding more chapters in years to come.
I'm sure there's a lot more chapters in the years to come. And I can't thank you enough for signing my book for me. That was just great. I mean, if you guys go to the track, go on, Amazon or wherever they sell books, it's The Sheer Power, or The Sheer,
Shall I say it?
Yes, please.
The Sheer Force of Willpower.
Thank you. I knew there was a force in there somewhere.
Yeah, it's not The Sheer Power of Courtney Force.
No. It has nothing to do with the Force family. And yeah, so, but, I have to tell you, it's the only book I've ever read where I wasn't told by a teacher to read it. So, and that's saying something, trust me, because I'm not a reader, but right. I got to tell you, it was a great read, couldn't put it down. And I mean, it's a fascinating story, very fascinating story.
We've been musing over it for a couple of years, and I just, he knew that whenever he felt the need to write a book, which I'm not sure he would have ever felt a need, an Australian publisher, HarperCollins Australia, in fact, they thought it was a good time, and well, I guess chilled out after winning the championship, agreed. And I was delighted to jump on board. How well it's selling, I don't know. But it was, I think he found it quite therapeutic to talk it all through. And I think I thoroughly enjoyed getting my feet wet in book publishing. God alone knows when I'll feel that inclination again. But a couple of ideas are brewing.
All right. And I love that, like, when you signed it, you left a spot on the top for Will to sign it, and you're like, so are you going to get Will to sign it? I'm like, well, I mean, it took me 2 years to finally, ask the man for a sounder for the show. So maybe I'll get him to sign it one day. And I figure 5 years down the road, if I'm still doing this show, which I hope I am, I'll finally get an interview with him. But, right now I'm just content on him being my favorite driver. That's all. Yeah.
So, okay.
But, but the book was great. And, you just learned so much about, that you just never actually knew or thought or, just could even conceive,
And, those kind of drivers are always the best ones to write a book about, because there's a lot of drivers out there who literally do wear their heart on their sleeve, and they're constantly on social media, and so you know all the stories within there. The fact is, Will, as a shy guy who's also now a Team Penske guy, therefore, corporate savvy, I think there's a lot of people that assumed he was bland, and I'm thinking, no, he's one of the most psycho guys I know.
Yeah.
If he gets angry. but he's also got some very cold, hard opinions that he muses about very rationally. And so my purpose was to get that across and also to explain his roots. I mean, you've got to bear in mind that before, pre-2006, I had no idea who he was other than just a name who was doing great in Formula Ford down under. But I literally knew nothing else about him. So finding out his Australian roots and, speaking to all the guys down there who worked with Will in the junior stages of his career was really, really interesting. And then a lot of the other stuff I had half written in my head anyway once I'd given the green light to the project. So those bits came easier. Even so, it's amazing that as you get older, your memory does start to fade, and you do occasionally have to, look up in the books. Was that 2010 or 2011 when you did that?
Tell me about it. Yeah. I mean, Missy and I have been, Will Power fans since about 2009-ish, somewhere around there. And, we even, what year was that when he... we even get it screwed up sometimes, so
yeah
I know exactly what you mean, but 2014 was just so gratifying, because we've been fans of him since 2009, and just seeing him coming so close, so close, so close, and just it was always that last race where something would happen. I mean, he was the king of bad luck. If he didn't have bad luck, he would have no luck at all, kind of guy, And and that and that really horrific crash that he was in at Sonoma, at the top of that blind hill. I don't remember what turn it was, but oh my God. And but when he came back the next year, I mean, he gained so much respect for me, just to get back into a car after that, because that had to be terrifying. So and that's when I really respected him a lot. And and as far as his racecraft goes, I mean, he's second to none, as far as road and street courses go. And he's starting to get a lot better on the ovals. And I mean, come on. I mean, he didn't even race in St. Pete this year, and the last race of the season, which, by the way, 11 straight years now in IndyCar, the championship has come down to the last race of the season. That's pretty amazing in itself. But it being Will Power this year and him missing an entire race, it was just mind blowing.
No, I mean, he definitely he had that wonderful run, which kind of replicated Simon's run from earlier in the year, where he couldn't finish anything other than first or second. I mean, it was remarkable, and he's definitely never had a run like that. And in the middle of that, he finally had what he said was his first ever kind of like lucky victory in terms of it being luck against the guy that you're kind of contending for the championship for, which was, of course, Toronto, where he had just pitted just before the yellow came out. And Scotty Dogg and Simon got shuffled back. And, like Will said, it's so weird to have one of those actually go his way rather than against him. Because so often, Dario used to be the master, especially at Toronto, actually, of going in just a couple of laps before Dixie and Will did, and it kind of like pretty much made him home free because his two chief rivals had been shuffled back in the pack. But I mean, that's the nature of it, and I mean, the theory is that what goes around comes around. I just think for Will, it took a long time to come around. And the other thing is, you look at a guy that, like Justin Wilson, unfortunately, often those opportunities never did come around. It comes down to being with the right team so that you're able to at least keep knocking on the door, and eventually it'll open. The problem is, so often Justin's team would be a long way from being where he could reach it to knock on the door of victory lane.
I mean,
I'm just saying that we have to put bad luck into perspective. That was real bad luck to not be able to ever be in that opportunity that Justin's talent so obviously. I mean, you imagine Scott Dixon or Dario Franchitti that have been in, without meaning to piss anyone off, but a Dryan Reinbold and a Dale Coyne racing while they were in one of their down seasons. I mean, it's just weird how history turns, but that is the caliber that say a Justin Wilson was, and it would just be horrible to think that there was another bunch of guys like a Scott Dixon or a Dario that didn't get that opportunity because they've been in middle of the grid teams for a long time. So I think, when we describe someone's bad luck, there's always a sense of perspective to keep in there.
Speaking of Justin Wilson, I was telling Rob Howden about, how our show came to be, and Justin Wilson was instrumental in that. We were friends with Justin for a few years before we started the show. And basically, Steph Waugh-Kraft and Paul Dalby—they had more front wing, and loved the show, and always wanted to do radio. Was very, very nervous to do it, and I didn't want to compete against them because I didn't want to take any fans away from them. I wanted them to have fans. I wanted them to, have a great podcast. But when Steph became, a freelance journalist, and she started racingnorth.ca, I saw an opening, and I was telling Justin about it. It was at Pocono, and he made a deal with me, and he said, "I'll tell you what, I'll tell you a story." And he told me that when he was racing for Minority in F1, the 1 year he couldn't fit in the car; it was too small. He just couldn't fit. It was not happening. And then he said that they came up with the solution where they made these little bump downs in the bottom of the tub where his heels sat for 3 inches deep. And that 3 inches was the difference of Justin Wilson fitting in the Minority and not fitting in the Minority. And I thought that was like, wow, 3 inches was the difference of you racing and you not racing? That's crazy, And he's like, but, I never gave up, I mean, I was heartbroken, I was devastated, but I didn't give up. He goes, and if you go for your dream like I did, because I had so many people against me saying, oh, you're too tall, you're too this, you're too that. He goes, whenever you want, me on the show, you just ask and I'll be there no matter if I have a seat or not. And to be honest, the 3 times that he was on, because our show wasn't very old come last Pocono. But he was on the show 3 times. The first 2 times, he did not have a seat, And the last interview that we had with him was at Iowa right after he got his full-time ride with Andretti halfway through the season. And I've never seen him more happier. And, that's one of my most favorite interviews I've ever done. And yeah, we have it up on YouTube, and everybody can go see it at www.theindiesportscarpodcast.com. Definitely encourage people to check it out. And that's really the Justin Wilson that pretty much everybody who knew him, that's the Justin Wilson that I remember, always big smile, always happy, So, he was basically the straw that broke the camel's back of my basically my insecurities, so to speak, and I went for it, and we're at, week 99, about to go to week 100. So, and I have Justin Wilson along with, Steph Walcraft, who spent some time with me and, kind of just, told me what to expect and everything else. And Kelly was also Kelly Brule was also very instrumental on how to promote the podcast, so we actually gained a fan base. So those 3 people right there, I can't thank them enough. And it's just weird how who helps you and who supports you throughout your as you go on. I mean, was there anybody really instrumental in supporting you and following your dream as being a motorsports journalist?
It sounds corny to say your family, and it wasn't entirely. It's not entirely.
That's not corny at all.
It is not entirely true either, because
it's a good question. When I stumped David Melcher, all right, I kind of feel good about myself.
This is why I write for a living instead of talking. I would say that my parents were probably more realistic than I was, in that they warned me that I'd have to write for local newspapers before I got up to where I could write in magazines. And they should have been right, but some higher power or my dead grandfather or something was watching down on me, because the fact is, while I was at journalism college, I did work experience at Autosport magazine, and at the end of my work experience period, basically they said, hey, when you've passed your exams, come back to us and we'll see if we got a job for you. And that's exactly what I did, and they did. I was slightly charmed, led a slightly charmed life in that regard, because I didn't have to work my nuts off to, you know, I ended up combining my passion, which was racing, with the one skill that I had at school, which was English. And so, yeah, I got really lucky there. And I don't, you know, I hate to sound smug about it, because there's a lot of people that are in dead end jobs, you know, bank tellers or car hops or whatever, you know, they just don't want to be doing what they're doing, but they just do it to make ends meet. And I'm one of those lucky sons of be allowed to do exactly what he wants to do.
Well, the world needs the scissors too, you know. No, I mean, what impresses me the most about you, David, is I won't stare you down in the media center or anything, but you know, the press, you know, the press will be going on of, you know, let's just say, I don't know, qualifying, right? You know, the top six will come in and they'll talk, right? Halfway through the presser, you're walking outside because you're done. I have no idea how you do it. And then you go and read your article, and your articles are so perfect. They're not long, they're not short. You get, you know, you're not left with any questions. You have your graphics, you have, you know, great headlines or whatever, and they're headlines that grab you, that make you want to read the article. You know, a lot of people, they throw these crazy headlines out there that have nothing to do with what the article's about, right? And then you read the article and you're like, why do you, okay, so he came up with the headline to grab people's attention. That's all that was for, right? But, right, you know, your headlines, you know, it makes sense. Exactly what I read is what the headline was. And like I said, not too short, not too long. It's to the point. I never leave reading anything you write with a question. And that's the sign of a great writer, a great journalist, you know? And, yeah.
Well, I mean, I've got something else to confess on that, though, however, is that halfway through a media conference, and, you know, it's quite often I do like to be near the door so I can creep out without disturbing it. You know, part of it is simply the fact that I don't want to be in there asking a question and letting all my competitors get the same answer as I do. That's not, you know, that just defeats the purpose. It seems foolish to, you know, for me to come up with something worthwhile and for me to effectively donate it to various other competing websites. So I think, well, hang on, if they say anything worthwhile in this, I'm going to get a transcript of this in my inbox, you know, in 20 minutes or whatever. So after the top six, you know, Firestone Fire 6 have been in there, meanwhile, I'm out patrolling the paddock, trying to catch up with the mechanic of the guy who finished eighth, but should have been in the fast six, or the guy that sucked hopelessly and is sitting 20th after a disastrous qualifying session. If I haven't seen why that happened, you know, if I haven't seen him stick it in the sand trap, then I want to know why that guy finished. So I'm thinking, you know, I'm going to get the top six transcription anyway, and hopefully someone will have asked a worthwhile question, and hopefully someone will have given a worthwhile answer. But that's not my priority, is not to get the stuff that everyone else is getting. That just defeats the object of journalism. I want to get the stuff that no one else has got.
Yeah, that's a great answer. Didn't expect that answer, but it's kind of brilliant. That's a great answer, David, really.
I mean, that's my motto, kind of brilliant. But
kind of brilliant, David Mosher. I like it.
No, I mean, it's just, I don't know, it just seems...
No, logical. I mean, it's very logical. And I'm a very logical kind of person. Like, everything I do, I think, you know, five steps ahead of it, and, you know, and then I try to do it the easiest way possible. And that's basically laziness, but it's also, you know...
Laziness has driven you towards brilliance. That's great.
There you go. That's my motto right there.
Well,
But yeah, I mean, and there was a there was something else I just wanted to say, and I totally just it just flew the coop on me. Oy. Anyways,
and while I'm on, I would actually like to say the graphics that you mentioned, they're just some miracle worker in the French arm of motorsport.com. Someone seems to be able to turn those damn things around within like 10 minutes of a session ending, and it never fails to impress me. And so by the time I've finished off the report, they're there, and I can just cut and paste them in. And they're great little graphics. I love that stuff because he updates them. So when Montoya's, this year had like 14 different liveries. This guy knows which one, oh, he's in the Hawk car this weekend, or he's in the PPG car. And I don't know the name of the dude that does it, but by God, he has my undying respect.
Yeah, I mean, tell me about it. I mean, well, me, like my favorite is when Montoya looks like a giant pumpkin. You know, that orange livery. I have no idea what the sponsor is, but it doesn't
Oh.
matter to me. He looks like a pumpkin.
Yes, I did discover the name, Devil Bliss or
That's
something. It
it.
sounds like it
Yeah.
should be the name of a very exotic chocolate. But it's I have no idea what they do. This is a great thing about Penske sponsors. They're usually really, really top notch, and yet you take them for granted for so long, and you think, actually, what do they do? It took me a
Yeah.
long time to realize that Hawk did more than just brake pads. They actually do like braking systems for cars, for example. And Mazak that you see on the side of a bunch of
Sure.
Penske cars, they do actual machines for building tools that build machines. It's, and I think they have a base somewhere, is in Kentucky or Cat. Kansas, it's somewhere beginning with K. It could be the killing fields, but no, I don't. I would have not realized that at all. And then I went to the SEMA show a few years back, and Mazak had a stand there. And hey presto, that's what they do. There you go. Sorry, that was a very tangential part of the conversation there.
No. I
So
mean,
tell me,
I had no idea what they did either. Like,
where do you think Montoya should go?
what, now that he's out because Joseph took a spot?
Yes.
I don't. Where should he go or where will he go? I think it's two different questions, really. Where
Well,
should
I assume you
where?
don't know where will he go, because even he doesn't know at this stage. So I'm asking, where do you think he should go?
I think he should go to Ganassi because that's the second best team in the paddock, and I think Montoya is the caliber of driver that deserves to be there. But I don't think he will. I think he'll end up someplace like I don't know, Foyt maybe.
Oh, interesting. Controversial. But
Well,
okay.
I mean, I haven't heard of anybody, who Foyt's really after. Other than Foyt really wanted Joseph after he raced at Road America after that surgery. That was pretty much the only reason. But other than that, there was no way Joseph was going to Foyt. I knew that, but I know Hawksworth is out, and there's a seat there. I mean, it's basically just, where are the seats? I mean, is Ed Carpenter going to take them? No, I think Ed Carpenter's going to probably take Ed Jones because he comes with two races in the Indy 500 that doesn't have to pay for. I don't know. And I mean, it's a rumor, it's not official, but Sarah Fisher may have a team next year. Who knows? I mean, it's a possibility. So hey, why not grab Montoya? What do you think?
I think it's Carpenter, Ganassi, or the possibly combined KV Carlin thing.
So,
But I
you
seriously,
still think Carlin is going to be part of IndyCar next year, huh?
yeah.
Okay. So Trevor's just been telling people he has no, it's not going to happen. Maybe 2018 at the earliest, but it's not going to happen next year. he's saying that to throw people off the scent?
I mean, last time I spoke to Trevor, he said he was some way off, but he was still hopeful. And to be honest, the thing is, I don't know whether it's a blessing or a curse. I don't really surf the internet to see other people's opinions. I never go
on
comment forums. So if he said something more recently, I'm trying to think when I last spoke to him. Actually, about that, probably 4 days ago. He said it was like some way off, but he was also saying, well, but on the other hand, we've got October, November, December. I think they're going through a process of due diligence. I don't think it's a coincidence that Cal Coben is moving that team to Florida. I mean, you could say, well, that's where he lives now, but then again, that's not crucial because he's lived in, you know, California for a long time, and the shop's been based in Indy. So I don't think that really comes into the equation. I'm sure he'd like it to be nearby, but I'm sure it's not the crucial thing. So, yeah, I believe KV and Carlin will hook up eventually. If they don't, then I would suggest that KV is going to be a one-car team. I think, again, and Carlin will have two, but I mean, he's spoken to both Honda and Chevy, and Trevor says that he says deciding on which of those is so, he says for one thing, he doesn't know that it's definitely his decision, but he's not bothered either way. He says that is, you know, like 19th on the list of priorities right now. It's doing, I think, you know, they're like two potential lovers circling a room opposite sides during a nightclub, and they've kind of eyeing each other up and just seeing which of them has the courage to say, do you want to dance? That kind of thing. I think they're a bit further down the road than that, but they're not bumping and grinding yet.
right on. Actually, Adrian Ricard, IndyCar UK, he gave me a interview that he did with Trevor at Laguna Seca, and he gave me another interview also with someone right off the top of my head, but I'm putting together basically the two interviews, and I'm going to be releasing that on Saturday. So. Right. I guess we'll see what Trevor has to say on Saturday from, you know, back at Laguna Seca to 2-3 weeks ago. So, but you've talked to him 4 days ago, so that's a little bit sooner than the interview that I have. So, I don't know.
Well, it's probably, now I come thinking it's probably 4 working days ago. So, probably actually last Friday. But I mean, he was being careful, of course.
Sure. No reason to show.
He was standing by to make sure that he didn't say anything indiscreet. So, I mean, the thing is, I'm always grateful when people talk about these kind of plans, or at least kind of like explain the process of what they're doing, because they're under no obligation to speak to us Muppets about it. It's very much down to what they feel they can reveal, and if someone says, I don't want to talk about it, then you got to respect that, because there could be something hanging in the balance that they don't want spilling out into the media. And it's also often a sign of someone not being comfortable with the media, like worrying that the journalist is going to dig too much out of them. Whereas, I much prefer the Chip Ganassi way of just shutting you down, saying no, can't talk about that, and that's entirely fair enough. It's their business. So I mean, when someone is able to open up about it, that's great, and Trevor's been very frank with me in the past, so when he's not able to be that way, I know that there's a reason for it. So let them go do their own stuff and then come back to us when there's something tangible.
Exactly.
But, I do worry that we, as media people, can sometimes if we get it right, we can be accused of blowing up the deal sometimes if it's been a secret deal. And then if we get it wrong, we then look losers. So I think it's, you know, and as my grandfather said, you know, sit still and look stupid or open your mouth and prove it. So I'd rather sit still and look stupid. And
and to be honest with you, David, that's exactly why Missy and I, we, you know, it's really no secret. You know, we say it 100 times on the show. We pretty much use motorsport.com exclusively for all of our content that we talk about on the show because of that very, mantra or philosophy, if you want to call it that, of your journalism, of what you write about. You know, there's people that will write about rumors all day, and there's people that will write about facts, and you fall into the latter, and that's why we pretty much stick with that, because we don't want to say anything that is just rumor, you know, because if it's not, you know, fact or almost fact, you know, then we just don't talk about it, you know.
Well, I mean, the one thing I will kind of like give rumors, but I will always flag them up. I'm never, you know, my whole policy is that nothing's certain until it's fact. So I would rather, you know, I'm happy to conjecture. I mean, we all love standing around, don't we? Just talking about, well, if he goes there, then that guy could go there. But he's not going to work with that engineer because he's already done that and chewed them out in the past. And so it's lovely talking about this gossip. But when you actually go to put it down on paper, there's old school journalism. When you go to put it down for a website, I think that there's a lot of, you start to, I think it was Justin that told me that, if you just get one thing wrong and then you build upon that, you're going to be way wrong by the time you get to the end of it. So, oh, sure. You know, you just have to present it as conjecture and say, you know, this is what I know. And I know people have complained to me in the past saying, oh, you know, if I use the expression paddock rumor or according to our sources, they want to say, well, what sources are they? And I'm saying, well, if I revealed that, believe me, they would cease being sources. So I'm afraid you're just going to have to suck it up.
Yeah.
And just trust me on the fact that I had a very good source on this. And that source can be, you know, the guy changing the tires. It could be more usually it's a rival driver or a rival team manager that is best at revealing this, but they're not going to ever reveal anything to me again if I say who it was that I got it from. So that's yeah, if you want me to give you the kind of like speculation, then that's part of what you have to put up with, the fact that I will just say two strong sources or one strong source has suggested that. But yeah, I will always flag it up as I will never put it down as, oh yeah, this is the gospel according to Malsha, because yeah, the world's already got four gospels, they don't need a fifth.
I mean, you know, that and that reminds me of you know, a source that we had pretty early on too about why Honda never made a aero package for a dome skid, right? And everybody was asking, why are they waiting to the last possible second to build this package for a dome skid for the Indianapolis 500, right?
Yeah. Right?
Nobody's tested on it. You know, it just seems like, you know, it just seems asinine that they would just not do anything with it, right?
Yeah.
Well, you know, we have, you know, we very credible source. We will never tell you who it was, but we straight up said it's because Honda thought that they were going to flex their muscles and say, we're going to race on a flat skid or we're not going to race at all. So if you want to be responsible for having 17 cars or 18 cars in the Indy 500, then be my guest, right? And IndyCar turns around and goes, okay. And then we'll say it's because you, Honda, refused to, you know, abide by the rules in the rule book that was set back 6 months ago. And good luck with that, you know, pitfall. And then Honda made a dome skid aero kit. I fully, you know, trust the source that told us that. I will never reveal that source, but that I know exactly what you mean. And people might get mad, like, well, tell us the source. Like, well, no, I'm not going to tell you the source, because then people will not trust me with, you know, information. So, you know, and that's what it comes down to. And I asked Rob Howden a question after our show the other day, and I asked him. I said, I was talking to somebody, and he told me a whole lot of stuff, right? I got most of it, but I didn't understand a few things, right? So how do I if I don't understand it, then how can I come to understand it when I can't reveal who said it to me or anything else? And Rob just basically said, just keep it to yourself, and basically you'll eventually figure it out, and then you'll be smarter for it. And you would not have burnt a source. And he's dead on with that, you know? So I'm glad I asked Rob that. So, but you're definitely right, you know?
Absolutely. And you know, the other thing I've found is that I can be given information that I don't understand, or I want to, I perhaps haven't considered it from everybody's perspective. And so there's a few, trusted sources in the paddock. And so if I told you this, what would be your take on that? And, generally I will then kind of hear all sides of the story. And if I hear a team owner just ranting about something because it just annoys them, it doesn't suit their agenda, then that's not good enough for me. I will then go to, other sources, because, you can always detect when someone's complaining about something just because it's not going to suit their team. And
Or they're just mad.
They've campaigned the other way for a long time, and they've been defeated in the last team owners group meeting. And I think ultimately if we get as many opinions as possible about it, I think that always quite often I have to just present those opinions rather than give my own. I might write a column, a commentary column, an opinion column about it later in the week once I've discovered it from, or kind of like really considered it from all angles. But, there's a very big difference between news journalism and feature journalism. And, quite often I can completely disagree with the person I'm talking about. But if they explain their point of view eloquently and in a way where they are actually talking about the betterment of the sport, then if they passionately believe it, I may think they're completely 180 degrees wrong. But as long as they do it well and with sound logic, then that's fine by me. The point is, it's not up to me. I haven't got any skin in this game as far as, piling, 6 and 7 figure sums into this sport. This sport has only ever given to me, and I have to remember that all I am is just a measly journalist, and if I disappeared, I'd be replaced by someone else. Whereas I do think that there are a couple of drivers and team owners whose absence does affect the sport. So it's always important for journalists to not get above their station and just remember that a lot of the time they are just conveying news that they have heard. They don't, the reader doesn't want to hear a twist in it. They want to know the facts, and they don't want, and this is a big difference, and I could disappear off onto a complete rant here, but I'm not going to, but this is a big difference between trying to be a journalist and someone doing a blog where it's like It reads like what I did last summer.
Yeah, I know exactly what you
Such
mean.
posts to present the blog, we don't care how it affected you. All you are doing is, conveying what happened in the paddock. It doesn't have to be your take on what happened in the paddock.
Yeah,
And
well,
so that's
because the only one that really cares
subjective.
about what your take is you. And that's
Exactly.
not your audience, you know? Your audience is the fan base. So
Yeah.
you want to present it to what they want to hear and what will, grab their attention, and make them happy after they get done reading it, or make them think after they get done reading it,
Yeah, and there's always room for writing with passion and from a personal perspective. And I love it, but it's also the easier side of it, as far as I'm concerned. Once you just
Sure.
it starts flowing, that side of it's fine. It's finding out the proper hard news, about who goes where, or why this engine let go on this qualifying run, or why X driver is 7/10 of a second slower than his teammate, or whatever. That kind of stuff is actually the hard part, because you've got to force people to be really honest. Whereas the stuff that you're just plucking out of your head or heart, that stuff's easy because that's what you believe already. So that stuff flows. The hard work is getting the facts, getting them down, and letting as many people know about it as you possibly can, which I hope motorsport.com does in all fields. Not, I'm not just talking IndyCar,
Right.
We have some of the best journalists on the planet in Formula One, in Jonathan Noble and Adam Cooper. They've been at it for a long time. They know how to get their sources to reveal stuff that no one else has. And I'm constantly in awe of them.
I would imagine that, getting anything out of Formula One is extremely difficult.
Exactly, and that's why they have been there forever, and they've paid their dues, and they have very good contacts deep within teams. And some of them are drivers, some of them are long time, crew chiefs and mechanics, and in a couple of cases, a couple of team owners. There's a lot of inside intel, and the governing body shares a lot of stuff with motorsport.com. FIA shares a lot of stuff with motorsport.com. At times, and we're eternally grateful, but we never know specific sources because Jonathan Noble isn't the kind of guy to exactly what we're talking about. He isn't the kind of guy to blab where it's coming from. So, yeah, no, we love. That's the thing. That's the thing that unites us all is that we love what we're doing. I'm sure you love what you're doing, and
Oh yeah.
we sure as hell don't do it for the money.
I mean, I look at, being in the media center and everything, that is the, that is the payoff, for what we do here. I mean, just the experiences that we get and just the people that we get to meet and and all that, it not only, heightens the the stories that we can tell and the entertainment that we can bring to, our fans and our and our listening audience. But, it also for us, for Missy and I, it's a, I mean, I'm in a media center with the likes of you and, Kirk Cavan and, I mean, I remember the first media credential I ever got. Within 5 minutes, I was talking to Paul Page, and I couldn't believe it. It's just.
Oh, like I know, I was actually like that whenever I encountered someone that I've heard on TV. I'm like, oh my God, I've heard that voice for so long, and
Well, Paul Page kind of has like a very special place in my heart because of a memory of my father, of Little Al winning the 92 500, and Paul Page was the voice of that memory, and that's one of my favorite memories of me and my father. So, that, and then I actually shared that with him. I couldn't believe I actually did that, but I shared that with him, and he was just, he's like, "Thank you for sharing that with me. That was very nice." He was a very nice gentleman,
Yes,
and.
no, he
Yeah,
is absolutely.
he's a very nice guy.
So,
But you know what? David, I can't thank you enough for coming on. And if you ever feel like coming on and talking instead of writing a little bit, the door is wide open, and we can always record whenever you want, Dave, really.
Well, unfortunately, the luxury of what I do is that I can always go back and delete stuff, whereas since you guys don't do any edits or much editing at all, I'm
And the
always a lot
fans
more.
love it.
Yeah, no, I don't doubt it. Yeah, you get us warts and all, and I'm not sure that's something that will ever be completely comfortable, but I would like to praise you for doing something that I do think is completely overlooked. Everyone wants to get on TV, everyone wants to get on YouTube, but I do still feel that podcasts and radio telecasts are some of the most evocative, memory creating things that anyone can do, because you're painting a picture with your mind and it will stick with you forever. And you just listen to some of the radio broadcasts from the Indy 500s of the past, and you do not need to see the visuals.
Nope.
If someone is doing, Sid Collins is doing his job, then he is painting a picture for you to kind of like formulate the shapes and sights and sounds in your mind. You can hear the crowd going off in the background. And I have to say, radio broadcasting from that point of view is still fantastic, and I hope I hope it's not a dying art, and that we do all go to just visuals, because after listening to a race or any kind of sport on TV, I mean, tennis, you think tennis on the radio would be awful, but if you've got a commentator that can keep up with the
Sure.
power plays, then they can still create a wonderful atmosphere for you to understand exactly what's going on, and they have to be descriptive. And it's I think radio broadcasting is still something very precious, and I admire you guys for doing podcasts like this. And thank God podcasts have caught on big time, and it's not just everyone trying to make themselves famous by sticking their face on YouTube. No, this is great. So, congratulations, guys. I'm glad it's reaching its 100th week next week. And you should be highly proud of your enthusiasm, emanating to all your listeners.
Yeah, David, I don't know what to say, but thank you for the kind words, David. I really appreciate those kind words, and it's exactly how I feel. And I really think that a lot of people out there still feel the same way you do, and I'm grateful for that. And I feel the same way. And I just want to say, that meant the world to me hearing it from you, because I respect you, very much, as a journalist, and hearing that come from you, that means the world to me. And when Missy hears this, she's going to probably cry, to be honest.
Well, it's going to make Missy cry, but no, good on you guys. And the important thing is that it's made with enthusiasm. You don't sound world weary. You still sound like enthusiasts, and that's very important when we're fighting for a very small brand, a small branch of a small, a relatively small sport when we compare it to MLB, NFL, whatever. So,
But that's what's great about it, I think.
But the only way to spread the word and get more people enthused is for us to be enthusiastic about it ourselves. And you clearly do that, and that's why you spend your own money going to all these damn races. So,
Yeah.
good for you. Good for you.
Yeah, and then to be honest with you, if you haven't been enthusiastic about the last 3, 4 years of IndyCar racing, then you're just not a racing fan. I hate to tell you. It's time to find another hobby.
I think this is true. I agree entirely. No, it's been a truly wonderful period, hasn't it?
It almost feels like this has been the payoff that we've all been waiting for, the past couple of years. And I've been thoroughly enjoying it, and I can't wait for another 100 episodes to see where we're at then,
Yeah,
So,
absolutely.
But like I said, David, where can they find you on social media there? And and again, I just wanted to mention that motorsport.com did merge with not merge, but what's the right
Acquired.
word? Autosport.com and motorsport.com is now one, or?
Motorsport.com acquired all of Haymarket's motorsport assets. So that's Autosport.com, Autosport magazine, Motorsport News magazine, which is a kind of like newspaper format magazine. And along with that came the Autosport show that's held in Birmingham, England, every January. The Autosport Awards held in London every December. And I think I'm leaving one out, so I'm sure my boss will stab me in the neck the next time I see him. But of course, the wonderful world of LAT, their vast motorsport archive that goes back to probably 1904, that has also come under the motorsport.com umbrella. So I guess you speak to me on quite an epic day for the company.
Yeah, I mean, I like when I got the email and I saw that this morning, I was like, wow, this is huge news. And David's going to be on tonight. This is huge. Wow. And
No, we're very proud because Autosport is stretches back to from when World Championship began in 1950, and it's been it's still a great brand, and we're gonna do something with it.
oh, I can't wait to see what you guys do with it, and I'm sure, I mean, it was already great, but I guarantee it with motorsport.com backing it out, it's going to be even better. So I'm really looking forward to it.
That's the idea, dude. Right, I need to go and have my dinner.
Well, enjoy your dinner, and I'm going to enjoy re-listening to this and just saying wow, because this was just a great just a great 55 minutes of radio here, David. Really, really
So
was.
you shouldn't say 55 minutes because I bet you Missy's going to find some stuff she wants to edit out. So it's probably down to 30 minutes.
No, she doesn't know how to. I'm the only one that knows. But David, again, thank you for coming on, and looking forward to seeing you probably at Barber, I would say, is the first race we're going to make it into next year. So
Excellent.
looking forward to seeing you there, brother.
Okay, thanks very much. Cheers, guys.